Check.
Good morning, Mesa Church. I'm going to open us up in a prayer real quick. So, dear Lord, I thank you for today, Lord. I pray that the service goes smoothly, Lord. I pray that whatever shackles and chains have us captured today, Lord, I just pray that all of that's free today. I pray that people get freed of sin today, Lord. And I pray that today is just a day of rejoicing. And I pray this in your name.
Church, can you just say amen?
Amen.
Amen. So I know a lot of people are gone for the holidays. A lot of people are gone for certain things. My wife is in Albuquerque speaking at a women's conference. So the last few weeks, God has just been telling me, focus on him. Like, don't worry about everything else. Like, don't worry about having drums. Don't worry about our guitars and anything like that. Like, so today, as a church, we want to just focus on him. Anyone want to focus on him this morning? Amen. So if you guys could stand, I'm going to ask you guys, some of you guys, whoever is willing to be uncomfortable, these altars are going to just be open throughout worship. So if you want to come worship with us, like, we're acoustic, we're just guitars, like, come up here, come lift your hands, come sing with us, like don't stay in your seats. Like, if you need to run around over here on the sides, do it. But like, if you want to worship God, and it's only God, like, we don't care about the comforts of our chairs, we don't care about the comforts of anything. Like, today is a day to worship God. So if you want God, if you want his presence, if you want his anointing, like, today is that day. We're gonna sing with all of our hearts. We're gonna sing with everything inside of us. As I was praying, God said breath. And it was very simple to me. He said, the breath in my lungs is going to fill this church. He said, the breath in my lungs is going to destroy the yoke of bondage. The breath is going to bring things back to life. We are praying that the blood of Jesus, the breath of Jesus, is going to ignite this church. It's going to ignite this ministry. It's going to ignite so many amazing things in this place. So as we worship today, like, forget the week. Forget it. Cast it aside. Like, we're not focused on the sorrows. We're not focused on anxiety. We're here because we want to worship God and only God. Only God. Only God. Only God. So once again, these altars, like, come worship. Come worship with us. Worship at your seat. But we're going to just have an awesome time today. Amen. Hallelujah. Ain't nothing better than you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
I searched the world, but it couldn't
Matthew 11:28-29 says, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. All of you, take up my yoke and learn from me, because I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for yourself." Somebody in here today, I just feel it. Somebody in here today is praying for rest, and it's coming. He's gonna give you the rest you need. He's gonna give you what you need, and you're gonna learn from it. Just don't give up hope. Keep praying for it. Keep doing. Keep moving forward. Keep going, and you're gonna get the rest you've been praying for.
Sometimes I find there's a fork in the road. Should I stay? Should I try to climb higher? To do what I'm made for, to know the good shepherd, to breathe in the air of the mountain, fill my lungs with the air of the mountain. You are my hope. Vision in the heights, miles and miles high. I don't see you getting tired. Oh, good shepherd, I follow where you lead. 'Cause your steps have tested the strength of the ground before me. And fear cannot hold me. I'm set on the mystery. Your invitation is calling. Though faint is my strength, you're my eyes, you're the way. You give grace to my faith, so I'm climbing. You give strength to my day, so I'm climbing. You are my hope, God, my vision in the heights, miles and miles. High. I don't see you getting tired. Oh, good shepherd, I follow where you lead. 'Cause your steps have tested the strength of the ground before me. Good shepherd, you're faithful to take the lead. The way may be long, may be wild, but I know you're with me. I know you're with me. No place for me anymore. Even broken feet could not keep me from seeking the one who faced death out of love for me. You said, "Follow me," so I'm following. The foothills are no place for me anymore. Even broken feet could not keep me from seeking the one who faced death out of love for me. He said, "Follow me," so I'm following. The foothills are no place for me anymore. Even broken feet could not keep me from seeking the one who faced death out of love for me. He said, "Follow me," so I'm following. You said follow me, but I'm following. Oh, good shepherd, I follow where you cause your steps have tested the strength of the ground before me. Oh, good shepherd, you're faithful to take the lead. The way
Amen. So we're just going to stay in the atmosphere of worship. We're going to stay in his love. Today, for offering, we're not going to do nothing major, but it's a form of worship. So I wanted to do it during worship. If anyone wants to give, the baskets are up here. Anytime, like it could be after church, it could be now. Make it part of your worship today. So that's all we're saying. So Father God, pray over this offering. Bless it. Bless those that give. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. So we're going to sing one more song. And these altars are still open. I know there's some people that want to come up here and they want to just break through. Like God says, break through. There's people that need God. They need God. Come get God. That's what he said. He's like, I'm here. I'm faithful and just. Like if you seek God, he is faithful and just to find you. Like, he is there for us. He is our Savior. He is everything. He is so good. He loves us so much. We're going to sing this song, How He Loves. And I know you guys know it. I know it's an old song. But we're going to sing it because sometimes we have to remind ourselves that we are worthy of what he says we are worthy of. Sometimes we feel like we can't make it. Sometimes we feel like we're not able to go on. But we are worthy to be sons and children of God. The Bible says that we are friends of God. We are friends of God. The infinite God in all of creation wants to be friends with a nobody like me. And I can't help but to give praise for that. I can't help but to say, God, you want to use my hands and my feet. You want to use my mouth. You want to use my breath. I can't help but to give praise for that. I can't help but to say, Lord God, I need you more in this hour. Lord God, I need you more in this season. Lord God, I'm grateful. A lot of times we don't know how to pray, but Lord God, I need you. Lord God, I thank you. Lord God, you are good. God says, I heard the cries of this church. I heard the cries of the people. I heard the cries of this sanctuary. I know the city of Raton. Like, I feel the urge. God is just saying, like, I feel such an anointing in this place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We're not rushing God this morning. We are at his call. We are at his beck and call. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. So as we sing this song, like, sing it. Sing it. Know that he loves us. He is jealous over us. God is jealous over us. He's like, I don't want them worshiping Satan. I want them worshiping me. Nobody's like us he cares about. He cares about us. He cares about us. He loves us. Says the Bible says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he said, his only begotten son, that whosoever believes shall not perish but have everlasting life. Amen. So he loves us, that he sent his son to die for us so that we may have a relationship with him, that we may get to know him, that we may get to have a relationship with him. That should blow your mind. It should blow your mind that the God of the universe wants to have a relationship with us. So today, God, we ask that you come and you meet us where we're at. Lord God, you come and meet us in this church. God, you come and you tear down walls of depression, walls of anxiety, walls of lust, walls of hurt, Lord God, walls of anxiety, God, walls of suicide, Lord God. Every spirit that the enemy has brought in, Lord God, we ask that it leaves. God, we speak to any spirit to leave in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, for this city. We're declaring Raton a city of refuge. We're declaring this area a city of the Lord's. We're declaring Raton as a promised land full of milk and honey, Lord God. Lord, we rebuke any lies from the enemy, Lord God. We speak life over this area. We speak life over depression. We speak life over bondage. God says there's a lot of people that have been struggling with anxiety, but God says, I rebuke anxiety. God says, I died for anxiety. I died for those that are anxious. I died for those that are hurting. I died for those that are unworthy. I died for that. I died for that. So God says, we may live because he died for us. Amen. We may live because his resurrection power lives inside of us. The same power that rose from the dead lives inside of us. God, show that resurrection power this morning. Show that resurrection power this morning. Show off, Lord God. Show off your Holy Spirit, Lord God. We want to be in your presence. We want the awe of your presence, God. We want breakthroughs in your presence. We want freedom in this church, God. We just rebuke anything that is not of you, Lord God. God says, like today, as far as the east is from the west is how far he forgot what you did this week. He said, like, I'm not worried that you might have sinned. I'm not worried. He says, just repent and get in the right standing relationship with me. That's what we want. We want to just be in a right standing relationship with him. Hallelujah. Once again, if you guys want to come worship with us up front, if you want to get on your knees, whatever you guys need to do, God is here today. He's a God of miracles. love him. Talks about a church that it appears righteous and it appears like it's all these things, but it says you need to return to your first love. You need to return to your first love. We don't want to act like we got it all together, church, because we don't. We were in bondage. We were slaves to sin. We were slaves to so many things. But God came in and he set us free. He came in and he delivered us. So today, it's not about us. It's about him. It's about him. We love him so much because he died for us. So God, return us to our first love, which is you. Return us to that day when we first met you at these altars, when everything started to seem clear. We love him, church. Oh, how we love him. Let's rest, church. Let's rest just a few more seconds. Hallelujah. Breathe into our bodies, Jesus. Breathe into our lungs. Breathe into our spirits. Hallelujah. Glory. Glory, glory, glory. Father God, we thank you so much for everything that you're about to do today. We thank you so much for everything that you have already done. You could do nothing else in the rest of our lives and it would be more than enough. But you choose to love us enough to bless us. You choose to love us enough that we are in your umbrella. When we are in your hands, nothing can pluck us from your hand. Nothing can pluck us from the enemy. Nothing can pluck us from your love, God, from your son, from your grace. So, Father God, we pray your Holy Spirit into this service, God. We don't want us. We don't want Josh. We don't want Bevan. We don't want Soraya. We want you, Jesus. We want you, Jesus. We want you, Jesus. We want you, Jesus. You are more than enough. One more time. Soraya, can we just sing, "Oh, How He Loves Us"? No music. Just words, and as a church, let's sing it. If we sound horrible, let's sing it. Let's sing a joyful noise to God.
Yeah, he loves us.
Give God praise in this place. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, so much for everything you are doing and you are going to do. Amen. You guys can make your way back to your seats. If you want to stay up here, that's 100% fine. Kids Church, you guys are dismissed. You guys go with Miss Teresa. We're going to get some stuff together and we're going to get into service today. Amen. If you want to real quick, go ahead and greet each other. And take us a few seconds. So.
Test.
Check, check. Amen. Let's start making our way back to our seats. Amen. Hallelujah. You guys love Jesus in this place? Amen. I know we have a lot of people gone today, so I'm going to need y'all to be extra loud today. Can y'all do that? Do you love Jesus in this place? Amen. Hallelujah. Patricia is speaking at a women's conference in Albuquerque today, so keep her in prayer. She's going to be doing her breakout session tonight, so we're super excited about that. I'm super excited about everything that God's doing. We have a few announcements. I appreciate every one of you guys because everyone's been hitting me up today. They're like, how come y'all didn't schedule me for nothing? So I know you guys always want to volunteer, but today we're just focusing on God. But if you do want to be a volunteer, kids church, cleaning, ushers, security, anything, get with me after service. We always need help. Amen. I mean, we're a growing church and we need help. Amen. Amen. So we have a few announcements. So no youth this week. No, Are you guys doing prayer tomorrow? No, I don't think we're doing anything this week. We're going to celebrate Thanksgiving like with your family. So take a rest, take a break, and just enjoy the presence of God. Amen? So enjoy your family, enjoy your fun. Anyone making turkey? Everyone? Anyone do something other than turkey? Sierra? Yeah. She's like, I ain't cook, I just eat, right? I don't blame you. Right, yeah, so some tamales. I hope we get some of those in Houston. We're actually going to Houston this week. So we're excited for that. So the youth is actually doing a Bible plan. We did one as a church last week, and they said if anyone wants to get in the Bible plan with them, you guys could just get with Bevan. She'll send you the link. It's about Thanksgiving. So anyone that wants to be interested in that, that will happen. So another announcement is December 3rd. Everyone say December 3rd.
December 3rd.
We are going to have a three-day revival. Pastor Evangelist Joshua Humphrey is going to be here Friday night at 7, Saturday morning at 10 a.m., and then Sunday morning. So it's going to be awesome. Make sure you guys make plans to attend that now. He's been going all around the state of New Mexico just seeing, just equipping the church. So, like, his main thing is teaching people how to pray for people, teaching people that they are worthy, teaching people that you could prophesy, that you could witness people, that you could get people saved. So Saturday morning, so Friday night we'll have a service. People begin filled with the Spirit, everything. Like, I've been following him on his journey, and it's been awesome. But Saturday morning at that 10 o'clock, he's just going to be coming doing a training, and then people are going to go hit the streets. So we're gonna come, we're going to meet here, we're going to pray, we're going to get a little training, and then we're going to go out in the city, and we're going to pray for people. So we're super excited for that. Be praying for that event. Be praying for the harvest of God. Amen. I don't know if there's last announcement is if anyone knows any families in need this Thanksgiving, just get with me after church. We got some Thanksgiving cards for those in need. If you are in need, hit me up too. Like, we're just gonna give some super safe cards to super yeah. Amen. You guys know what I'm saying. I'm not used to doing all this stuff. Usually I have everyone scheduled, so it's my fault. I should have just scheduled people. Amen. I'm just kidding. But we're going to get into it today. Are you guys ready? Amen. If I think of other announcements along the way, I will let you know. Like, our kids' church is going to be doing some Christmas awesome stuff. So for our Christmas service, which is coming up, I think it's the 19th, our kids are going to be doing a play. They're going to be doing some songs. So make sure you bring your kids the month of December, because they're going to be practicing in kids' church. We'll get more with that. I told Soraya to learn Silent Night on the piano, so they're ready for that. So that's going to be awesome time. We're going to have a potluck that day, and we're also going to be giving away some Mesa Church Christmas ornaments. So we're believing for like 14 million people, because Ozzy's going to make some pozole. So... I'm just kidding. Amen. But we're believing God's going to bring so many people in. So I think that's all the announcements. I'm going to stop talking about announcements, okay? So Father God, thank you so much for today. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your anointing. Thank you for your glory. Thank you, Lord God, for meeting us where we're at, Lord God. We thank you for this awesome time of worship. We thank you for the time of worship with not only our voices, but with our offering, Lord God, that it tied all in together today. So we know that you are a mighty God, you are a big God, you are a saving God. There is nothing you cannot do. So we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Sierra, can you grab me a water? I think there's some in the safe. Amen. Amen. I love our church. Do you guys love our church? Amen. So in Habakkuk, anyone know how to say it? It says to write down your vision plain on tablets. So you guys might wondering why you have these cards on your seats. My mom's got some pens. She's going to start handing them out to people. But anyways, so what we're going to do during the service is we're going to write down our prayers, our visions, stuff like that. So if something just comes up to you during service today, write it down, and we're going to believe that God's going to answer our prayers. Amen? So 7/31/2018. I'm going to read some of my journal entries, okay? Actually, 8/7/2018. So this was about, we started the church on 9/21/2018. And I actually got a new job, so I was cleaning out my office, and I found my old journal. Amen. How many of us, it's good to, amen, thank you so much. It's good to journal. Right? It's good to write down your prayers. It's good to look back at those things. So I got a new job, was cleaning out my office, and I found this journal of right before the church started. And I thought it was really cool. Anyone think that's pretty cool? Amen. So we moved back to Raton with the expectation that we were going to help this other church, and they were going to help let us be pastors, and we were going to help it grow. We had plans. We already had remodeling. We already had all this vision that God showed us. But when we got to Raton, it just didn't work out. We were sitting in the church, and we were doing nothing, and we were kind of sad. We're like, God, I know you want us to do something. I know you want us to move. I know you want us to preach. I know we didn't move back to this area for nothing. And I was working, and I was like, maybe God just wants me to work. It's his season. It's not my season, right? So 8/7/2018, I'm just going to read some of these journal entries. Is that cool with y'all? Amen. It says, today I pray for direction. Let your divine favor walk with me in every situation. When I turn left, be there. And when I turn right, let me know you already have my steps ordered. Divine favor through impossible heartaches. Divine favor when I deserve help. Let your favor be on my life. Daniel found favor with the king because he was exceptional. Let me go above and beyond in my job and in my Christian walk. Lord, I want to preach. I have a desire in my heart to start a church and see people's lives change. My desire is for everyone to know you. Let me create. Let me design. Let me produce new, innovative, creative ideas to help spread the gospel. I am yours forever and ever. I just want to be an instrument in your mighty hand used for changing the hearts of people. Amen. So 8/8/2018 says, Lord, I trust in your goodness. I do not depend on my job for finances. I do not depend on my job to provide. You are my source of peace. When I want to worry, you are my safety net. When I want to cry and give up, I believe you have big things in my future, a better job and a better salary, as well as preaching. I know that I'm a preacher. I know that I have your anointing flowing all through my veins. Let me trust in you in this messy, uncertain situation. So I remember thinking, like, God, you've called me to start this church, and you've called me to do this stuff. And so that was my prayer. Like, my prayer wasn't, like, so I would be a pastor. My prayer was to see lost souls saved. Amen? So this is like a week later, 8/14. It says, Lord, I'm trusting you in this season. I'm believing that you will send the harvest. Amen? We've been praying for the harvest in this church since we've been here. Amen? I'm believing that you will send workers, laborers, and people with vision. I cannot sit back and do nothing. I'm a child of God filled with the Holy Spirit. I will not be shaken when trials come. I've been through the fire, and I've come out without the smell of smoke. I trust in you. So 8/15. So this is like a month before, like, the church and stuff. It says, I'm uncertain of the future, but I know that you are with me. Troubles come at me from every direction, but your shield covers me. Let me put on the full armor. Let the shield of faith be my anchor in this season. Faith for a job, faith for a church, faith for finances, faith to see you bless the family, my family, faith for kids, faith that you will provide all my needs. So, I mean, just trusting God in everything. Lydia wasn't even a thought yet, but we were praying for her, right? Me and my wife had a hard time, like, making kids, but God makes the babies, right? Amen. So 8/17/2018 says, let it be done. I'm trusting that you're ordering my steps. I'm trusting that my faith in you is all I need. I know faith without works is dead, so I want to work. I want to start a church. I want to preach. I want intimate time with you every day. You are my hope. Let me focus on your kingdom. I want to do your will. I want to see lives change and be impacted. Let your will be done. I am your servant in all situations. Open up doors now, Lord. Jesus, I want to walk through open doors. Amen. So thinking back in this season, I was just like, God, I know you have called us back to this region for a certain purpose, but it wasn't happening yet. So I was just praying every day. I was journaling. I was seeking God's favor in my life. Amen. Anyone ever do that? It's important. So 8/30/2018, I'm not going to read too many. It says, Lord, you made a way in the wilderness. Amen. How many know that God makes ways in wilderness? You made a way when doors closed. You opened the impossible doors, Lord. I thank you for favor, Lord. I thank you for guiding our steps. I cannot begin to thank you because you are too good. I ask for messages. I ask for inspiration. I ask for souls to be drawn to Mesa Church, right? It says, your table has enough room for me. Thank you for your unfailing love and kindness. So there was 13 days in there before journal entries. And I was reading, and it was just like, I'm praying to start a church. I'm praying for you to open doors. And then 13 days later, I'm praying for Mesa Church, which is, like, kind of crazy, right? Like, how fast God moved in that situation. So this is the next month, 9/7/18. I'm just going to read a few more. It says, I only need you. I rebuke Satan in the mighty name of Jesus. Remove his bondage from my generation. Rise up a mighty army of believers that refuse to tolerate his ways. I break curses in the name of Jesus. I come against condemnation on the believers. There are no circumstances that his grace cannot cover. We plead the blood of Jesus over Raton, New Mexico, and this region. Rain down from heaven your blessings and your freedom. We are not chained anymore. We are free in the name of Jesus. We come against Jezebel spirit. We come against lust. We come against anxiety in the name of Jesus. It is written that no weapon formed against me shall prosper. The gates of hell cannot destroy the church. Mesa Church will stand. Mesa Church will battle. Mesa Church is ready to battle. Your table is for all. The love is for all. Lord, I ask that you rain down from heaven. I pray for my wife and her insecurities. Lord, I pray that freedom will flow in her, through her, and people will know your freedom through her worship. Amen. So I think there's like two more I want to read. Amen. This is pretty cool. I hope it's cool for y'all. But so 9/14/2018. And it just says, I feel your presence falling on my life and on Mesa Church. So this is before we even opened our doors. So the last, we got news that God was going to open the doors, and we got news that we were going to do some stuff, and we got ordained. Like, all kinds of stuff started falling in this place. So it says, I feel your presence falling on my life and on Mesa Church. Start drawing people to your table. Start a tugging in the hearts of the people. Send in the prostitutes and the drunks and the rich and the poor. Let us have room at your table. Let us make room at your church. Let us prepare for an outpouring of souls coming in to get saved. Lord, continue to provide our finances. Lord, continue to make a way in this church. Lord, I trust you and only you. You are the calm in my storm. You're the rock in my shaken areas. You stand firm in every situation where my boat started rocking. I praise God for all that you do. Amen. So one more I'm going to read. And this is 9/21. This is like our, when we were about to start. I think it actually says right here, we are a day away from our first ever event at Mesa Church. I have never seen your faithfulness fail. Your mercies endure forever. Your grace is enough. Lord, we thank you for the walls. Amen. We had a couple walls we built, and the stage. It was a little tiny stage, and the coffee area. The coffee area was a table with the coffee pot on it, right? It was awesome, though. You are so faithful and beyond amazing. Thank you for it. I know this was your faithfulness, because things like this don't just happen. Amen? I mean, sometimes we have to remember we serve a God where things like this don't just happen, right? It says, in less than a month, you started a church from the ground up. No one can deny that you are God. No one can deny that you tear down walls of insecurity. You tear down every veil. You made a way in the desert. Lord, I pray for my job. At that time, I was praying for background checks. I was leaving everything in his hands. And then I just wrote, praise to you forever, Lord Jesus, the name above all names. Amen. So just give God praise. I think it deserves praise. Amen. So as I was reading these journal entries about starting the church, it brought me back the memories of how God answered prayers for this church. And he has since the day we opened until now, right? Anyone ever been without in this church? If you have, like, I pray that God is going to start filling this place with so much more. Amen. If you turn to Acts chapter 12, we're going to dig into that a little bit this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So continue writing stuff down too. If you guys think of something that you're praying for, write it down. If there's something that you've been struggling with, write it down. If you're praying, write it down. Looking back at all my journals and stuff, like, there's so many memories of, wow, God answered that prayer. I was reading my other entries, and we've been praying for help, and God has sent help from all around. Amen. It's so good to see. So write them down. Write whatever you see down, whatever vision you have. If it's your mom, if it's for cancer, if it's for anything, write it down. Amen. So in Acts chapter 12, verse 1, it says, about that time, King Herod began to persecute some believers in the church. He had the apostle James killed with the sword. When Herod saw how much this pleased the Jewish people, he also arrested Peter. He also arrested Peter. This took place during the Passover celebration. Then he imprisoned him, placing him under the guard of four squads of four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring Peter out to a public trial after the Passover. But while Peter was in prison, the church prayed very earnestly for him. Amen. So we're going to stop right there, and then we'll get into it. So the king, he got news that when you kill Christians, the Jewish people get happy. How many know sometimes, like, when we get persecuted, people get happy. When a Christian falls, I don't know if you ever watched the news, but when a pastor falls or someone like that, people in the world are like, see, I told you they were all hypocrites. I told you they worship a false god. See, I told you that what they do, they don't understand about God's grace. They don't understand about God's love because they come from a judgmental spirit. So in this story, you guys know Peter, right? Peter was preaching and 3,000 people got saved and people were added daily to the kingdom. Peter was also the guy that denied Jesus, but Peter was also like Jesus's right-hand man. So when they threw Peter in jail, he thought like the devil probably thought he won, right? How many know when the devil gets you in circumstances, he usually thinks he won. But how many know it says what? It says the church prayed very earnestly for him. Amen? How many know sometimes when we're going through some hard times, what do we got to do? We got to pray earnestly. The Bible says the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Meaning the earnest prayer, a prayer with faith from a righteous man could move mountains. It could do a lot of stuff. And it talks about the prophet who prayed and no rain came down from heaven for 40 years or 40 days or whatever it was. And when he prayed again, it started to rain. So we have that kind of power when we pray. So it says the church prayed very earnestly for him. Amen. So when you guys are going through situations, when you're going through trials, when you feel like there's no way out, God says, make sure you're praying. Amen. Make sure you're praying. When I was in a jail cell, my brothers and my sisters in Houston and all my family in Houston, they said, there ain't nothing we could do. So they gathered at my sister's house and they said, but we could pray. Amen. And I thank God that I had a family that prayed for me when I was at the lowest of lows, right? So when you feel like there's nothing you could do, when you feel like the doctor don't have an answer, when you feel like the counselor don't have an answer, when you feel like there's nothing you could do, what can we do? We could pray. Amen. Because God is a God of answers. God is a God of miracles. God is a God of second starts. God is a God of second chances. It says the righteous fall down 7 times, but they get back up. Amen. I serve a God that has said, you know what? I want a church that gets back up. Amen. So Peter was in prison. The church did what? They prayed. Hallelujah. So verse 6, it says, the night before Peter was placed on trial, he was asleep, fastened with 2 chains between 2 soldiers. Others stood guard at the prison gate. Amen. So the night before he was going to go to the judge, like God intervened, right? How many know sometimes God will intervene at just the right time, at just the right moment. Amen. It says, suddenly there was a bright light in the cell, and an angel of the Lord stood before Peter. The angel struck him on the side to awaken him and said, quick, get up. And the chains fell off his wrist. How many know when God comes, chains fall off your wrists, chains fall off your legs, backs start to get healed, depression starts to leave, amen? You might be in bondage, but God says, I'm sending angels in this region, and chains are about to fall off, amen? It says, then the angel told him, get dressed and put on your sandals, and he did. Now put on your coat and follow me, the angel ordered. So Peter left the cell following the angel. But all the time he thought it was a vision. He didn't realize it was actually happening. They passed the first and second guard post and came to an iron gate leading to the city. And this opened for them all by itself. So they passed through and started walking down the streets, and the angel suddenly left him. So as the angel of the Lord led him out of the prison, it said like doors started opening, right? Said that door started opening without anything Peter doing. Amen? And I believe that's a word for the church this morning. He says when you pray and when you seek him, he says the right doors are going to open and you're not going to have to do anything about it. You're just going to be led by the Spirit of God. Amen? When we started this church, it wasn't because Josh was trying to start a church. Like, I wanted to preach because I wanted souls to get saved. I didn't come to start a church. I came to be a witness from God. But God says, you know what? I'm going to open up doors that were once shut. I'm going to open up doors that seem impossible. That building on First Street that we were in was a miracle because the landlord says, I don't want a church in that building. So when I was writing this journal entry, I said, God, you open up doors that only you could open up. He says, I don't want a church in that building. But yet when we started to pray and we started to fast, he called us back and he said, you know what? Like, I believe in your mission. I believe in your vision. And we were able to open up a church where he wanted a department store. Amen. So God says, follow him in this season and watch the doors open. Verse 11, it says, Peter finally came to his senses. It's really true, he said. The Lord has sent me his angel and saved me from Herod and from the Jewish leaders, had what they had planned to do to me. Sometimes it's kind of, I kind of feel like Peter. I kind of feel like, man, it's really true that God is using me in this circumstance, right? Anyone ever been like that? Like, wow, God, you're really using me to reach my family, God. You're really using me to start a church, God. You're really using me to sing, to play, to do anything for him. Like, it blows my mind how good God is. I hope some of you guys get that feeling in your life where it overwhelms you, the love that God has for you, and he will protect you from evil. He will protect you from heartaches and all this stuff. Like, we serve a big God. Do you believe that? Amen. Amen. So it says, when he realized this, he went to the home of Mary, the mother of John Mark, where many were gathered for prayer. It says he knocked at the door in the gate, and a servant girl named Rhoda came to open it. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed that instead of opening the door, she ran back inside and told everyone, Peter is standing at the door. You're out of your mind, they said. When she insisted, they incited, it must be his angel. Meanwhile, Peter continued knocking. When they finally opened the door and saw him, they were amazed. He motioned for them to quiet down and told them how the Lord had led him out of prison. Tell James and the other brothers what happened, he said. And then he went to another place. So Peter went to the house where the people were praying for him. Hope you guys get this. Like, Peter was in jail. The church was praying for him. And literally their prayer walks through the door. Amen? Is that exciting to you? Like, literally as they were on their knees praying, Peter walks through the door. And they're like, that must be an angel. That must be something else. Because there's no way that God could answer prayers that fast. But how many know we serve a big God, right? We serve an effective God. We serve a God that when we pray and when we get on our knees, God is a God that answers our prayers. God is a God that sets people free. When we were praying for our church, I said in less than a month, we built walls, we built stages. Money came in from the north, the south, the east, and the west. Aunties that I haven't ever talked to in my life started sending me $100 bills and says, go buy a piece of lumber, go buy a piece of furniture, go buy some chairs. Like, it didn't make sense except that God answers prayers. Amen. Sometimes it don't make sense, like how God could do it. But if God is doing it, we need to give thanks. Amen. God is saying this is a season to give thanks because he has done so much, exceedingly abundantly, more than we could ask, think, hope, or even imagine. That's the God that we serve, that prayers will walk through the door in this season. Amen. As I was driving back from Albuquerque, I don't know if you guys seen my little truck out there. It's a little beat up, but it's a lot nicer than what I had. I got gifted a truck. Some guys saw our message online. He says, God told me to give you a truck. And I said, thank you, God. I've been praying for something like that. Amen. It's cool. It's cool. We serve a big God who does big miracles. Amen. I know we don't have a lot of us today. Y'all, I need y'all to get excited for the things of God. I need y'all to get excited for the anointing of God because this church is a miracle from heaven, right? Like, this church has reached a lot of people. There's been hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people in this doors that have heard the message of God. There's been young people that have been fired up. There's been people that have been sick that have been healed. There's been people with broken ankles that have walked out of here. Amen. There is a testimony after testimony after testimony in this place. And I don't serve a God who is little. I don't serve a God who doesn't do big things. I serve a great God. Amen. So what we're going to try to do before Christmas time is we're going to build a wall where that ugly wall is, where the coffee is, and we're going to call it our wall of miracles. We're going to paint it the blue like our chairs, I think. We're going to write wall of miracles on it. We're going to have pens outside of it, and people are going to write testimonies after testimonies after testimonies of what God has been doing in their life, right? Like, the Bible says we overcome by what? The blood of the Lamb and what? Anyone know? The word of our testimony. the word of our testimony. I believe people are going to come in and they're going to read those testimonies, and God is going to start setting people free. God is going to start delivering people. Say, if he could do it for them, he could do it for me. If he could heal their marriage, he could heal my marriage. If he could set them free from cancer, then there's hope for my grandma. Amen. I believe that God is breaking down curses, and he's breaking down death, and he's breaking down a generation that the enemy thought he had. It shall not stand. There is land that has been declared for the devil in this season, but we take that land back. Amen. We're buying land. We're walking on land. Every step that we step on, God says, this is land that I have given the church. So go out. Like, I love that you guys are here, but I need you guys out there, right? I need you guys out there. I love you're in the seats, but we need you in the streets, right? Like, bars. I'm just playing. But that's what we need. We need a church that says, you know what? This is what God did for me. This is how God changed my life. I was addicted to pornography, but God set me free. I was addicted to lust. I could never hold a relationship, but God came in and he restored me and he delivered me. And now I got a marriage, and now I got a daughter. Now I'm running a church. Now I'm preaching, and now I'm doing amazing stuff, because it's only through God, because what he set me free. Amen. Like, we serve a great God. I believe that things are, like, miracles are going to start walking through the door. I believe we're praying for people and they're going to come through these doors, just like Peter did. Just like Peter did. He said, you've been praying for your dad for, like, the last 10 years. He says he's going to walk through that door. He's going to be on his knees at these altars. He's going to know the presence of God. I don't serve a little God, church. Amen. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 8. I'm sorry, you could play in the background. 8. Verse 26. I'm not here to preach today. I'm here to let y'all know that this is a season to focus on God. It's a season to focus on God. Like God just says, he says, the people are gonna come in. He says, are you worried about the people, or are you worried about my feet? Are you worried about bowing down to me? Are you worried about other stuff? Like, our live stream has not been great the last few weeks, and it drives me insane. But God's like, are you worried about that, or are you going to just pray? Are you worried about that, or are you going to just seek me? Like, little things like that, that don't mean much. What means much is the presence of God. Amen. So that's what we're doing today. We're going to write down our visions. We're going to write down our prayers. We're going to pray over them. And we're going to believe that they're going to walk through the door. We believe that at an instant, miracles are going to happen. The lady with the issue of blood, it says she spent 12 years talking to different physicians, different doctors, everything she could do, and she was just getting sicker and sicker and sicker, because nothing that she could do, nothing in the world and nothing on this earth could set her free. But she just said, if I could just touch Jesus, maybe my life will be changed. If I could just get a touch of Jesus. She didn't say, I want his right hand. She didn't say, I want a hug from Jesus. She said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, then I will be healed. And she reached through the crowd. It says she pressed through the crowd, like hundreds of people following Jesus every direction. And this lady was sick and dying. She had to literally fight through the crowd. I don't know if y'all picturing that. But she literally was dying an issue of blood for 12 years. Nothing could set her free. And she was fighting through the crowd and said, if I could just touch Jesus, if I could just touch his hem of his garment, then maybe my condition will be healed. She reached to the crowd and she touched him, and healing instantly left Jesus' body. We serve a God where if you have faith, he is faithful and just to forgive. He is faithful and just to heal. He is faithful. Amen. We read another story about the centurion soldier, and he's like, my daughter's demon possessed. He said, God, if you just speak the words, I know she will be healed. So you don't got to go pray over her. You don't got to go. I have enough faith that if you just speak the words, she will be set free. And he spoke it and she was set free. So we might not see some of our family members. We might not see them, but God says, just because you don't see them doesn't mean what you're speaking in prayer is not affecting them. We can't be everywhere. Our kids grow up. They go to college. They leave. But he says you could still cover them in prayer. You could still cover them in his anointing. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Romans chapter 8, verse 26. It says, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. The Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray for, but the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. And the Father who knows all hearts knows that the Spirit is saying, for the Spirit pleads with us believers in harmony with God's own will. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. For God knew his people in advance, and he chose them to become like his son, so that his son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And having chosen them, he called them to come to him. And having called them, he gave them the right standing with himself. And having given them right standing, he gave them his glory. So, God works best in our weakness. But it says here that God had a purpose for everyone. It says, for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose, that God causes everything to work together. So if you love God, you have a purpose. If you love God, you are called. If you love God, you are chosen to bring breakthrough in your family. If you love God, your light shines in the dark places. If you love God, like, we are not called to just sit back. We are called to participate in the kingdom. Right? Like, even when I wasn't preaching, I was preaching. Come on, somebody. Even when I wasn't on stage, I was preaching. Come on, somebody. Even when we're not where we think we should be, we are where God wants us to be. You might be in a job that might feel dead end. God says, start praying over that job. Start being thankful for that job. You might be in a relationship that you feel like it's time to end. God says, start praying over that relationship. He'll close doors if he wants them doors closed, but he'll leave them open if he wants them open. Like, why are we trying to do things on our own when God has a purpose for our life? Everything we should do, we should start with what? Prayer. Amen. Anybody write some stuff down? Hopefully everyone wrote some stuff down. Glory, hallelujah. There is nothing you can't do. Let's just close our eyes, church. I want you to think about that little list that you wrote. When I did this a few years ago, I said, Lord God, help us start a church. I said, Lord God, send in the workers. I said, Lord God, let us have our own building one day. I said, Lord God, bring in a youth group. I said, Lord God, bring in a kids ministry that's going to fall in love with you at a young age. I said, Lord God, can you just send in young people and old people in every tongue, every tribe, every religion, every race, every ethnicity, God? We want them, God. There is enough room for them at your table. And look what God has done. Look what God has done. Look what God has done. He is rising up a generation of believers in this area. He is rising up a generation of warriors in this area. He says, there was nothing that my right hand cannot do. There was no weapon in the enemy's arsenal that can keep you from his covering. Amen. The devil has tried. Witches have came in this church. The devil has tried, but he has not succeeded. We stand firm. There might not be a lot of people here today, but there is angels all over this room. God says there is a worship that is arising from this building. He says there is a joy that is arising from this building. He says that the worship and the praise of his people and the glory cloud from heaven is falling on this church. There is no weapon formed against us that shall prosper. Amen. I see young people. Hallelujah. God just gave me a vision of like young angels running around in joy. Running around in joy because this world is hard, but we chose to love God. So we leave our hurts today, God. we leave our hurts at the altar. We leave our hurts at the chair. And God says, there's angels taking them to heaven. He says, and from your weakness, I'm going to give you joy. He says, from your hurts, I'm going to give you freedom. He says, you give me your hurts, I'll give you joy. You give me your depression, I'll give you love. You give me lust, I'll give you love. You give me your bondage, and I'll give you freedom. Don't hold on to those things today. I know there's some people believing God for some big things. Me and my wife, we're believing God for a house because we want to have some more kids. Amen. Lydia is my angel. I love that baby. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. If you guys can, you don't have to leave them face forward or anything, but if you could just come bring your prayer requests and leave them at the altar. We want to pray for them as a church. Leave them on the stage, the altar, wherever. Hallelujah. God says there's people here today that are going to, they're going to see what they wrote on that list happen soon. God says, someone praying for an uncle says, watch. Someone praying for an uncle. He says, I am in that situation. If you guys need to stay at the altars, you can. You could pray. We don't want to rush God this morning. I know this is a different type of service. We're used to routine. We're used to getting ready. We're used to being done at a certain time so we can watch the football game. We're used to that stuff, but today, God, we ask God that you answer our prayers. There's so much hurt in this world. There's so much depression. There's so much suicide. There's so much tendencies for the world that we want to make sure that when we spend time with you, it's an effective time. It's a marvelous time. It's a miraculous time. Hallelujah. Amen. All of these prayer requests, stretch your hands, church. Stretch your hands. We're just going to spend a few minutes praying. If that's weird to you, just say Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. What God told me, though, he said, Josh, I want you to start praying for all these requests the way you would pray if Patricia was in the hospital bed. The way you would pray if something happened to Lydia. I'd be on my knees. I'd be torn. And yet, when people come to me with requests, I shove it aside. But God says, pray like that's your daughter. Pray like that's Peter in jail. Pray like that's your leader. Pray like they're about to, this is the desperation. We are a desperate church for a mighty God. We are a church that says Raton, New Mexico is the gateway to revival. We are a church that says Raton, New Mexico will no longer be known for doubt, but it will be known for hope and refuge and joy and peace and the love of the Holy Spirit. Like we're standing on the line for generations of witchcraft that has been done in this city. We're breaking that now in the name of Jesus. We're breaking that now. Any blood curses, any blood covenants, the only blood that matters is the blood of Jesus. The blood of goats never set no one free, but the Lamb of God. The blood of the Lamb of God has changed me. It has made me from a nervous, shy, timid young man to a mighty man of God, that when demons come, we say, leave in the name of Jesus. God says the authority on this church is not for the weak, but it is for those that love me. Hallelujah! 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 Amen. And in our weakness, he is made strong, church. Sometimes we just need to cry. Sometimes we need to cry and say, I can't do it. I can't do it. I can't do it. we think we got to play this fake Christian persona. We think we got to have it all together for our friends and family. But be real. Sometimes we just got to say, God, I don't know how to help my daughter. I don't know how to help this situation, but you do. I heard my mom pray that prayer so many times as we are struggling in our family and stuff. And she says, I don't know what to do, God. I don't know what to do, God. Like, I can't do nothing of my will. Every time I try to do something, it falls apart. Every time I try to do my will, it falls apart, God. But I need you to start working in my life. I need you to start fixing it. I need you to start fixing it. I need you to start fixing it. And when we start to pray with compassion, and we start to pray earnestly, and we start to see, God says, I heard the cries of this church. I heard the cries of this church. God says, I bottle up your tears. I bottle up your tears. Stop trying to act like we got it all together. God says, I bottled up your tears. He says, the doctors aren't the answer. He says, I am the answer. I am the answer in this situation. I am the answer in this circumstance. I am the answer in this time of need. Hallelujah. I pray over each and every single prayer request on this altar. Church, rise up and speak. Speak, speak. We pray over every prayer request at this altar. We pray, Lord, that the hands and the feet of God will be moved, God. We say that you send angels just like you sent Peter, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, that you break down prison doors. You break down walls of anxiety. You break down walls of lust. God says healing for your family members. God says you might have it all together, but he says you know you're praying for that brother out there. You know you're praying for that sister out there. He says, I heard your prayers. He says, I'm sending people that you would never expect to witness to them. I'm sending people from the east, the west, the north, and south that would never, that we couldn't imagine. And I believe that we're called to be them people too. We're called them to be them people that if my mom was praying for me, I pray that somebody would listen to God and meet me where I'm at. I pray that one day Lydia is just surrounded by good friends that witness to her and love on her and show her the love of Jesus. We don't understand how powerful the church is. We don't understand the joy that the church has. In our, the Bible talks about one of the greatest mysteries that God hid from all generations until Jesus came to die was the church. God's plan from all beginning of time was for us to take the mantle of God, for us to reach people. For us to be the hands and feet of God. Amen. So for 5 minutes, church, these altars are open. I pray that you guys come lay hands on the prayer requests. You don't got to read them. Don't be nosy. I know us nosy people. Amen. Just pray over them. So 5 minutes, even if we just walk in a line, kind of like in a line, and just lay hands as we go by. And if there's someone here that needs a miracle, meet me over here somewhere, and we're going to pray. But if we could just stand, and if we could just kind of line up, take your time, but pray over them, walk over them. Soraya's going to sing this song, and we're just going to love God. If you need prayer, meet me over here. If you need a miracle, meet me over here. And we're believing for these miracles today.
Sometimes I find there's a fork in the road. Should I stay? Should I try to climb higher? To do what I'm made for, to know the good shepherd, to breathe in the air of the mountain, fill my lungs with the air of the mountain. You are my holy God, my vision in the heights, miles and miles high. I don't see you get good shepherd, I follow where you lead. 'Cause your steps have tested the strength of the ground before me. And fear cannot hold me, I'm set on the mystery. Your invitation is calling, and though faint is my strength, you're my eyes, you're the way. You give grace to my faith, so I'm climbing. You give strength to my day, so I'm climbing. You are my holy God, my vision. Miles and miles high, I don't see you getting tired. Oh, good shepherd, I follow where you lead. 'Cause your steps have tested the strength of the ground. Shepherd, you're faithful to take the lead. The way may be long, may be wild, but I know you're with me. Oh, good shepherd, you're faithful to take the lead. For me anymore, even broken feet could not keep me from seeking the one who faced death out of love for me. He said, follow me, so I'm following. The foothills are no place for me anymore, even broken feet could not keep me from seeking the one who faced death out of love for me. He said, follow me, so I'm following. The foothills are no place for me anymore, even broken feet could not keep me from seeking the one who faced death out of love for me. He said, follow me, so I'm following. He said, follow me, so I'm following. Oh, good shepherd, I follow where you lead. 'Cause your steps have tested the strength of the ground for me. Oh, good shepherd, faithful to take the lead. The way may be long, may be wild, but I know you're with me. The way may be long, may be wild, should I stay, should I try to climb higher? to do what I'm made for, to know the good shepherd, to breathe in the air of the mountain, fill my lungs with the air of the mountain. You are my holy God, my vision in the heights, miles and miles high. I don't see you getting tired. Oh, good shepherd, follow where you lead, 'cause your steps have tested the strength of the ground before me. Oh, good shepherd, you're faithful.